on a good way to Missouri, but the time couldn't get a lot of opening was not fun. So, we're flying up from the Midway. Good picture. So, you have two catapults, no waist caps, so the launch airplanes, the front's gotta be clear. You can maybe park, you can park airplanes on one side, and then you just have one catapult, the launch is really small. So, in order to launch, you taxi up, all the flight bay director, they hook you up, and then settle, they'll hold back, you go full power on the signal. This, you can see, get less, the flight gear here is up, so that your exhaust doesn't blow down the flight bay. And then that will bouncer, make sure everything's good, that's just the thing, and you shoot off. Well, and once you're done launching your plane, it's time to recover them. To do that, this is the angle for it, this is the runway, angle back on the ship. That's gotta be clear. So, anything that didn't launch has to be clear of the power lines. You have fewer planes here, and then the parking spaces. So, as you land airplanes, you typically land, stop about here, and you taxi down, and you line them up to get them all over the front. So, launch airplanes, we recover airplanes, now the balance for airplanes. Once you get it now, what do we got to do? Well, this is where the shirts sort of come into play. You have to refuel them, typically you refuel them up forward, that's purple shirt. They have the refuelers on the ship. You have to rearm them if you're in the desert storm. You have the red shirts up there with the bombs, the missiles, and whatnot. You have to repair them or service them. That's the brown shirts. You've got the plane captains and the maintenance folks. And then you've got to take them when they're all up here. Maybe you're doing in different places, but you've got to drag them all to the angle, get them off the bow, get them out of the way so that you can start the launch sequence again. But it's the yellow shirts, you run the trajectories and flight deck directors and whatnot. So, on a lot of nuclear ship, they have water planes here on this side so that the waste caps are clear, the bow caps are clear, there's more parking spaces that are away from the busy parts of the flight decks. Well, the Midway was especially a ballet. They can move airplanes like no other. Similarly, you require tractors and ground crew for that. You also require ground crew for starting. The water ships have power up through the deck. The Midway was all carts dragged by a tractor. So there was stuff, people going everywhere to launch airplanes. And it happens on all ships, but it was more of a ballet on the Midway. With the desert storm. My purpose here is not so much, I'm not going to talk about how desert storm went down. I was on the ship, we didn't have CNN, we didn't know much of anything. We knew it was time to eat, it was time to sleep, it was time to go fly. We got some intelligence briefings, but we really weren't concerned with the conflict of the war. We were worried about what are we going to do today, how are we going to make this happen. So I'm going to talk about giving you some geographic orientation. We'll talk about some particular missions that I'm going on. If you have any questions or comments, please say so. I'm sure there's other folks who know a little bit more there or know a lot about it.
So how far off the coast would you say the ship?
So we're down here by Bahrain. And so this is the Persian Gulf, which for the purposes of this, it's renamed the Arabian Gulf. Don't know how long that's still. Here's Iraq, here's Kuwait, and we're right at the border on the east by Iran. In Syria and Turkey up here, which is up right now with Turkey. The Red Sea is over here. We have a couple very bad carriers over there. There's the whole Air Force and Army. We're in Saudi Arabia. And we also have some in the Mediterranean. Look a little closer. Kuwait down here. Iraq up north. There's Kuwait City. We do a lot of work at around Umkasser, the naval base, the Russian naval base, there were various oil rigs and things down here on Bubiyat Island and Malacca Island. We flew up into this part of Iraq, we flew up here north of Kuwait. So that is from the Red Sea, we're transiting across this way, more into Iraq, looking for Kuwait. So Desert Shield was the first part of this Odyssey feature. It's a KC-135, an Air Force tanker. But today's, it's actually KA-6, refilling on the KC-135. That's the bomber, an A-6 bomber. That's an F-18, and this is an A-6B, which was a big element from the A-6, and has 4 seats, and it does electronic warfare. Final on to this next.
Quick one, how long did you serve on the Midway?
About 2.5 years. 2 years, yeah. So, who here that I was not told knows that there was a sea story in a fairy tale? As a fairy tale starts once upon a time, a sea story starts, this is no shit. Desert Shield began on 7 August 1990. Iraq was invaded on the 5th. By the 13th, a week later, even just barely a week later, my squadron and other tasking to provide 2 A-6s to the Midway in the Persian Gulf from Japan. So, we took 3 airplanes from the Philippines. That's 2 out of there. Actually, took 2 lines and kind of broke that. Air conditioning was full hot. And it was going to work for a 7-hour flight. So we took it back and jumped in another one. South of the Philippines and down at KC-10 and the KC-135 out over the ocean. Following down for a ways, we've got gas from the 135 to run it back to the wall. And the 2-6 has followed the KC-10 to Diego Garcia. Diego Garcia is up by the Strait of Monica and well south into the ocean. Actually, a British invasion territory. It's a huge air base. So we showed up there. There are 2 A-6s. Sort of wandering around, figuring out how we're going to get them. After wandering around for a while, we figured out we got their airplane and then they're going to be flying. But we had to have a tanker. And that way to pass it. So we did, the best plan was to go to the club. So I'm at the club, and we found the KC-10 guys, and then we sent them around the drinks. We went over and introduced ourselves, and they said, yeah, what do you need to do? So, well, we need to go to the first computer to go. They said, well, we'll be up flying tomorrow about 8 o'clock. We're going to be in the waiting room about 8 o'clock. So we showed up at 8 o'clock the next day. And charter the KC-10. We launched off from Diego Garcia, joined up on KC-10, on it north. I was the senior officer in the flight. I didn't have to exercise my authority one time. I'm just giving you the quote. The quote was, "Fucking head, don't fly upside down by the tanker." The tanker had spent a bit more time at the field club than I did. Brought back to reality that morning, but he was fine. And he really made good form. So we arrived on the Independence, and the squadron CO was a very good friend of mine, Dave Nichols. We landed, we got there, they were recovering airplanes, we called them, they hit a pattern, didn't bolster landing good. And I saw Dave said, "How did you get here?" I told him the story of just a beauty, and I have way too many to stop, so I'm going to have to tell CAG this story. CAG is the air group commander. And so he said, "Come on, we'll go see him." So we went to see CAG. So we told him the story, and he says, "Can you come to dinner with the Admiral tonight?" So I was like the foreshow for the Admiral, for the Admiral's mess that night. I told the story again. And then they sent us back to my Anna met each other on the university at the DOQ that night. Said hi, went over to each other and said goodbye. Kind of a silly story for the old war. Went back to Japan, we go into squadron, I was the maintenance officer at the time. Played the board, played by the tower, and I think Desert Storm looked like sort of a dying event from the outside. What was actually going on there allowed us to get there and take the strike plans, develop the strike plans, and overlay the ground like Saudi Airways and actually fly the mission and do the tanking and do full rehearsals. It also gave the coalition forces time to see each other and talk to each other. So we had practice with the US forces, talking to AOAC, talking to the Air Force, and then also the other countries had chances to integrate into that. The Iraqis had found a complete plan of deployment before getting it blown down. Desert Storm, on the next slide, I'm going to do some outlines from some of the mission. Right on this slide, actually. So on the 17th day, the Air Force started to see. That night, I did fly. The airplane broke off the catapult. I was with the Air Wing Commander. And we ended up dumping our bombs in the water because one thing we had learned from that experience was, live by our board criteria. Our board criteria was no system, don't go for the beach. What's important, well, another sort of life lesson there was people complain about not getting the bottom of the mission or not getting the team medal that comes with it. But it's not, it doesn't make a lot of sense to complain about not getting shot at. There were other opportunities. I've got six missions here. There were others, there were anger missions, there were the bombing things. We can talk about these. So 17, there was the Iraqis had captured the Kuwaiti patrol going to have a 57mm radar rate gun on it. It was pretty good gun, and they were putting it under an oil platform under where we did our ingresses and egresses, bringing it out to shoot airplanes and putting it back up the platform. So Kagan and I took an airplane with four laser gun bombs and went up to seal the going on. There's a strike coming out, we were down lower, all the ships, all this thing that was back under the platform before we could get to it. So we made different runs from different angles, setting ourselves up, and we actually put two laser gun bombs in this patrol boat and sank it. But it wasn't quite that straightforward. There was something wrong with the fusing on the airplane. So we actually sank it with bombs that didn't blow up. there were 1,000 pound laser guided bombs that were about 600 miles an hour. They made pretty good holes in there. I mean, this is cool. While we're doing it, we're only about 60 miles off the coast. We're attracted to the attention of NSA sound guys. So we're very loud sounds. And for anybody who's seen this kind of thing, when you see the bright balls of fire going up in the sky, that's okay because those are going somewhere else. Because the ones that come off the ground and then stop, that's the problem. Because that means they're incoming. That made it exciting. This constant shaft, and we had an EW pod, and it worked. That was cool. So that was another. And then on the way out, the strike package had done its thing, and they're flying back to Midway. Our thing was for climbing back up the strike package, and so we flight to our F-18s. We would fly up an airplane and try to sneak up the strike package. So EW here goes off, big stroke, big light goes. So I turn all the lights on the airplane, and the stroke went away. It turned out a very good number of non pilot, all the shot, Nancy Haggard. And it was really bad for him. A few days later, we did a strike with what was Martin 20 Rock. I had 12 of them on the airplane against another oil platform that had been shooting at airplanes around the Gulf. We have seen pictures of the Martin 8500 pound bomb. Didn't arrive at it. So they have about 250 bomblets, and when they're paid away 500 pounds, they come off the airplane and dead cord and opens them up. And scatters these 250 bomblets over about a football field area. So 12 of those, I won't do the math, I don't do the public math, is a lot. about it, one way or another. Part of that mission was, there was some AAA, man, I was seeing on the platform, they were a big deal. It was a Mirage, Iraqi or Mirage fighter, or one of that kind of. Also, we got, we were being painted, but that was really exciting for that mission. We had a strike leader on a mission in Moon Concer. We were getting ready to try to interact with Navy. Shortly after those days, they left. We'll talk about that in a second. But at 1-3, that was done later, we got a bomb on the patrol boat sitting at the pier. And they also struck a couple of other A-3s that came out into the warehouse industry. So we were doing that from about 20,000 feet, using the clear to find the target, release the bomb, and the laser goes off the last 10 seconds of flight, the guys are in the spot. So we had a single patrol boat, we're all that way from up here. That's high enough that the aircraft was going on another big stuff to get up that high. The SAMs, those cannons that will get up that high, will take the guy who wants to build, who can. We saw some of those go by. This was a nice strike, so you can see all this activity. And it occurred to me then that there was, especially if you guys shooting the smaller AAA, the quota system. And sure, with one thing, if you get out there and shoot their quota, and there's airplanes coming, okay, we're going to kill 1,000 rounds, let's get out and shoot them and get back in the undercover. And they weren't actually shooting it. They weren't threatening us, but they were shooting like hell. January was a day strike, basically 500 pounders each. And we had some interesting fuses on the airplane for the problems. There were variable time fuses, so it's a small radar system that goes in the nose of the bottle and goes in to blow up before it, just before it hits the ground. It gives you a good way to scatter fragments out. Even with instantaneous fuses and the bombs, they'll tend to bury themselves about halfway in the ground. And so that limits what the fragments can do. So it's a lot of energy. So that was, we carried Rock High, we carried Mark 82, 500 pound bombs. We carried Mark 83, 500 pound bombs. Later we got a version of each, variety of things. To meet the needs of the targets. Even Mark 84, we got some couple of them, we carried those as well. The Grill War started the 24th. It was the famous 100-hour drill war. We did support that the Iraqis lit up or set fire to Kuwaiti oil wells. Caused smoke to be everywhere. Our clear was easy to have somewhat, but it's not visual, but it's still attenuated by smoke. Over 1,000 vehicles near the oil field. We saw in excess of 20 of the same firing on that mission. We saw some rare area activity, but it was fine. It worked out. And then later on the 28th, we fought Krumel Security again. That was as directly being pushed back to more troop concentrations further north. We did that. We also supported the for several retreat routes from the Iraqis. We dropped mines on a couple of those. I also took pictures of, you might remember when the Iraqis started pumping oil into their Gulf. So later you could make pictures of that, and I got that job. So we're flying up through sand belt, through under sand cover, taking pictures of oil being pumped into the Gulf. But it was important to take
On your first flight there on 17 January, was the intent not to hit the oil platform?
Yes.
That's why you were trying to get the right angle.
We figured if we hit the whole platform, the bomb would blow up on the platform and that we wouldn't get the boat. The primary thing was hit the ship.
So
we didn't really care about the whole platform, it was just
okay.
That way.
Okay. I was going to say, because the fact that it wasn't fused right probably was good in a way.
It
didn't blow up the old platform.
Yeah, well, we ended up putting a bomb because the Iraqis turned it into sort of a AAA outpost, so we ended up dropping a bomb on the mission. Day two, we were worried about the shooting airplanes.
Yeah.
let's get back. This is sort of why, it's sort of like, I'm going to talk about what happened after the storm on the next slide. Like, is there any airplanes or before I watch the next part?
How many
pilots actually work?
It's very rare. The numbers on the bottom, 98-99% kind of success. The laser guided bombs have electric fuses in them. So you get a single point of failure for multiple bombs. If the electric fusing unit is not working quite right, then none of them are going to work. Whereas these bombs and the ones these tubes have wires that the airplane actually holds onto depending on how you want to fuse. So it's more mechanical, not a whole lot. So you end up with sort of redundancy. For the electric fusing, there's a potential for a single point failure.
A-6, a venerable attack aircraft, 30 years of service, travel aircraft. As an engineer, what had you scratching your head? What was its glaring flaw or annoying? What annoyed you about it? What was Grumman thinking when you did this?
Especially toward the inlet, if we have to do a storm, the contrast was we were flying an analog airplane. Essentially, the clear was digital, but they're kind of basic analog. Same with the initial F-14. They were on high analog technology. So they just had an infinite number of failure modes. The digital airplanes, like the F-18, when we had asked if it's working, said if it's not working, we looked down and it's working. The A-6 asked if it's working, it might say yes now, and 10 seconds later, it might say hell no. It's the nature of the electronics and the ability to keep it working. We were running about 50 maintenance man-hours per flight hour on an airplane, which is a big way to fly when you retire. So the digital electronics may not have been more accurate, but they were reliable and consistent.
So you're pretty tall.
I had a long torso. I was running supposedly the max of what was allowed in the ejection seat. And with the A-6, you can eject the canopy off the airplane. You just pull the ejection handle, never go through the canopy. It didn't leave. The big question was, do you want to pull the lever and eject the canopy and make it not get all the way off or just go in and leave? But usually, my friends in the duty never really had a chance to think much. It was time to leave.
So that begs the question, did you ever?
No, I never got that. I did grab the cable a couple times. Go ahead.
Did you ever miss the cable on the Midway?
Oh, yes.
How does that feel like when you do it?
When you land on the ship, and you're trying to get a full tug, keep your plane in the correct attitude, so the hub stays down the deck, you get a full power, you roll down the angle back, and typically it'll take off before you get to the end. We actually practice touch and goes sometimes. Boarding rate for most people is 95-97%. So, and all the landings are great. So, the LSOs are back there watching, and they have you fly past. They'll grade it and say, what do I do? They don't care what to do. They don't care what to do. Boarding rate is definitely lower at night.
It's the most reliable avionics system on the A-6.
When it was the most accurate computer, they run it inertially, it's an inertial. Because they would work, some of them just work better than others. They would work, but some airplanes just didn't bomb with the dam. And you replace the inertial and all of a sudden it's bombed. The computer's still working, the radar's working, the radar's working. That seemed to be the most inconsistent with the inertial. And we didn't really have to, we would sit there and do the theory of famous people, and they would turn it up and send it back to us. It might work better for a while, but you've got power rails and all the tons of delegated equipment. You bang them off the chemical onto the deck a few times. on A-6. It had one, but we didn't really use it a lot.
I was just wondering, did you ever deploy with or operate with Marine A-6 and FAA's units, or was that a different mission set?
I did not, really. I know a lot of my friends did, and the Marines deployed on a number of carriers, so I did workups with them, but not much fun for deployment. 533 deployed with 75 after my first tour. And they, you know, we were acclimated with the ship, they were not. It was some adjustments to operate off the ship.
Oh. How resilient was the A-6 in surviving enemy damage?
Not particularly. And there was a lot learned about damage that was built. The biggest problem with the plane was the wing was stressed. So if you took a significant hit, and especially in the inner wing panels, that was a significant problem. Midway went through the entire Desert Storm War without any airplane being hit by anything. A-6s, there were several A-6s lost from other ships for various reasons.
What was your recollection of when 50 years after the end of World War II, the Japanese shot down the A-6?
I knew they'd gotten through the airplane. It was an A-5 with me. And that was just a standard screw up. A-6 could tell it turned its lead, which was especially helpful for close-in weapon systems, the Phoenix, the radar guns, the Hunter D2. On this Pacific exercise, the Japanese were participating with the Americans. And they had A-6 ships that proceeded, came after the Midway. I think it was the Indians. They still have charges from the Indian Navy. You took her about a mile and a half of cable, and you would overfly the ship, and then you would come. You would overfly, and they would turn the cable on, and they would see the target, so they'd come and they would shoot it. Typically, it was so accurate. They would shoot the target, save all of the cable. They would shoot right where the craft was attached. Well, somewhere in translation, there was some problem. They turned on early and shot the airplane up. The CMOs worked really well. They shot the hell out of it. But they voiced their they had a load of self-ejection. That was an interesting time. But since we're retiring A-6s, it was sort of a no harm, no foul thing going with the government.
I flew A-6, but I never heard that story until just actually recently that the Japanese had shot down an A-6.
That was the first airplane shot down by the Japanese since World War II.
I had heard that, but was there kind of a news blackout on it? Because I don't remember ever reading it.
Neither sound really important to talk
about. Or the Japanese didn't.
Yeah. It was an ISC, and so it was sort of, it had happened. You know. Look, who are we? Okay, so I'm going to hang around afterwards. I did bring some stuff. I brought the helmet that actually goes with the flight suit that's up there. I gave this to my son before I knew about the museum. And he's behind the opportunity to put it on display. I didn't bring it today. There's a flight jacket up there that I wore. I thought this one's the typical one I was issued. And there's some citations I had sent along with any of my stuff. I don't know what I have to talk about. Well, the calories upstairs as well. That was good to get out of my garage. So I gave this, I did a similar bit to this in 2013, within March. Mm-hmm. So a little bit of personal stuff, we're just a little bit of personal stuff now, that's okay, we've got a few minutes. So in June of 2013, I was diagnosed with stage 4 throat cancer. So I apologize for my voice today, but it's probably much better than mine. This is a picture of me with a quote from my co-workers in aerospace that they made while I was in chemo treatment. That's one of my more prized possessions. I went from about 195 pounds to about 135, 140. And 40 came out, 40 radiation treatments and 7 chemo treatments. Operation in AO clinics. This was an ordeal. But since then, every day counts. So thank you for being a part of this one. This one counts as well. We've done since then in recovery. My wife and I have done a fair amount of dancing, so my dancing career for a year, I appreciate that. I grew my bike a lot. That's a picture taken in South Dakota on the Middleton Trail, 120 miles or so, a nice vacation. I've done live skiing with my son and my wife. They were able to eat different. Last year, I weighed about 850,000. I had a good time skating. I've also done some other more emphasis on vacation and other kind of things. This is a trip to Alaska when you're a fish. That's out of 40 to 45 king salmon. Just got back from another trip to Alaska and brought some fish back. They work well. And then here's a picture of me and Diane. I'm very happy to be here to talk to you guys about what's going on with and certainly the cancer journey is one of all of us have life. So and it's really you can remember the other end change just as going to desert storm. King's County after a big change. I mean, so those are the things we take aboard in our lives and we figure out what they mean. But in this one, that's just things I'm grateful, grateful to be here today.
So, Glenn, one of my big bugaboos about your mannequin up there on display is the helmet. Because that helmet doesn't go when it's really quite
here.
Yeah, I know. Well, I've been trying to find one that would fit there. And I haven't yet, so. You sure your son wouldn't want to give that up?
I'll ask him. His client was a grand team yesterday.
Maybe.
Yeah. Give me a
okay, I understand. On your Midway deployment, you mentioned 7 bombers and 2 tankers. That's significantly less than what we deployed with at the Ranger, so I was wondering about that as well.
Midway 15 also had 7 things there, so I was putting together we had numbers on 4, which
okay.
That's
a little short. Yeah. So I was wondering, US pilot and the FBM, did you normally fly just one after your partner, or did you swap out whoever your band was?
We were crewed. We normally would fly about 75% of the time with the same band. If they had launch or something else going over, then mix and match. I also flew with the air wing commander. And so we split him with the other squadron, so I probably had 10%, 15% of my flights. But well, no.
If follow up to that, were you qualified as a VM as well?
No. But I was NATOP qualified. I did fly in the Red Sea a couple of times. Mm-hmm. Not off the ship. Right. But for NATOP checkpoints and stuff, I did fly over there. It was, I don't try to go on and do it. It was kind of not great. I did an interesting flight for off of Kennedy. We're in the Mediterranean. I took a Marine forward air server for a flight. We were potentially looking for things for them to start to shoot at. And so I did a little bit. I have a reputation of being a pilot who could at least talk to my through running the system. So it was sort of funny.
Have you been back to the Midway since?
Oh, I have. Yeah. Midway is a museum in San Diego. I don't know how many people are going to use it. It's a lot cleaner than when I was on.
Can I explain why it was important to crew piloting the MBA for coordination purposes?
Yeah, so all the checklists for a challenge of applying, the group, the There were those bits around, and when you're flying low level, you know, what's next, what's not, where at a certain point, how are we doing in time? So, the group of men had a lot of wait, and then you're getting the right information at the right time, and you sort of develop that chemistry between you as a crew. Similarly, we in your combat maneuvering, we couldn't see very much out the right side of the airplane. So it needed to have a communication protocol that was effective. So kind of flying with the same person all the time, let you build that up and say, I really needed to know about this. One more sea story, this is my shit. The last flight we talked about, we're going to go one on the concert. One thing I forgot to mention about that one was actually really about what the company bought on that mission. I'm going to do the airplane. Is that the right one? Yeah. Sure. Yeah. We're flying along by being in the helmet inside of cover. I saw this over there, like, what are you doing? I said, everything, I know everything is dead over there. Why are you doing it? You know, if we get shot down from some of the